country's capital, nation's pride. Its regal past, its cosmopolitan presence, world-class ways, leisure and comfort, style and elegance. We know. We care. We are Delhi Metro. Delhi Metro, which commenced operations in 2002, is regarded as one of the most successful urban transport systems in the world. DMRC has gained reputation as an efficient metro system developer and operator for actively playing the role of consultant for many national and international metro projects. Phase 1 and Phase 2 of Delhi Metro has laid the foundation of a robust mass rapid transit system in the capital, connecting all four corners of the city and the large part of NCR. The Delhi Metro started construction in 1998. The first elevated section with one line running between Shahadara and Tees Hazari on Red Line opened in 2002. Today, it stands as the largest metro system in India, operating 12 lines covering 389 kilometers and 285 stations. This is a commendable achievement. However, one must wonder, what does it take to build a system that works better than all other available public utilities, and how sustainable is this venture? The Delhi Metro Rail had faced a series of challenges during the construction, but the competent and proficient team of Delhi Metro knew the best to beat all odds. Delhi Metro could never have been built without the professional and dedicated team who was always ready with the best solution of any challenge during the entire construction process. Today, Phase 3 expansion has brought Delhi Metro on the world map and became an incredible tale of time, which has been successful in providing quality service.
The Phase 3 was much different than Phase 1 and Phase 2. Here in terms of volume, if you see, the volume of Phase 3 was equal to Phase 1 and Phase 2 put together. Then the Phase 2 was actually extension of Phase 1. And therefore, the technology-wise, the system-wise, things were similar to what it were in the Phase 1. But by the time we enter into Phase 3, there were many technological advancement in the world as far as the metro technology is concerned.
Phase 3 has connected the linear corridors of the earlier phases and made the metro accessible to most of the major localities of the city and NCR as a whole. It was the toughest so far in terms of engineering challenges. It involved work on 11 different corridors with 30 mammoth tunnel boring machines and workforce of nearly 30,000.
Phase 3 was again confined to the center part of the city, as compared to the Phase 2, which was actually extension of Phase 1, and we were going outside, like extension to Noida, Gurgaon. But Phase 3 was confined to the central part, like Inner Ring Road, Outer Ring Road, Old Delhi, Jama Masjid, Lal Qila area. So from the point of view of execution, this was more challenging as compared to the Phase 1 and Phase 2, both in terms of volume and also in terms of the challenges to execute the project.
Major civil engineering challenges that were encountered during the construction of the third phase of expansion were on these three corridors: Central Secretariat to Kashmiri Gate, Violet Line; Janakpuri West to Botanical Garden, Magenta Line; and Majlis Park to Shiv Vihar, the Pink Line. For Phase 3, DMRC not only had to dig through rocky terrain, pass through thickly populated areas and cross over flyovers, underpass and railway tracks, but also cross the hurdle of its own existing elevated network. While the Pink Line passed through Ring Road, the Magenta Line was constructed along Outer Ring Road, and the Violet Line entered the congested walled city localities that had centuries-old buildings and innumerable structures of historical importance. The Pink Line in particular intersects with different existing metro corridors at 11 locations and had to be planned and constructed keeping the existing metro corridors in mind. While Phase 1 and Phase 2 together had 47 kilometers of underground section, Phase 3 alone has 54-kilometer-long underground construction. To overcome numerous and unexpected engineering challenges, DMRC engineers had to come up with out-of-the-box solutions. Work on Delhi Metro's Phase 3 project started in 2011. It was one of the most challenging infrastructure development projects anywhere in the contemporary world. Violet Line, or the Heritage Line. The Heritage Line corridor of the Phase 3 is an extension of the Line 6 from Central Secretariat to Badarpur, with interchange facilities at Mandi House Station for Line 3 and the Kashmiri Gate Station for Line 1 and Line 2. The Kashmiri Gate Metro Station is the interchange station connecting Violet Line with Red Line and Yellow Lines of network. This line runs from Central Secretariat to Kashmiri Gate, covering a distance of 9.37 kilometers. The line connects the heart of Delhi, that is Janpath, Connaught Place, to the historical centers of Delhi Jantar Mantar, Agrasen Ki Bauli, Khuni Darwaza, Delhi Gate, Firoz Shah Kotla, Shahi Sunehri Masjid, Darya Ganj, Lal Qila and Jama Masjid, St. Stephen's Church and Begum Samruz Palace. Central Secretariat to Kashmiri Gate Corridor was one of the first corridors of Phase 3 on which work began in May 2011. And it is a completely underground section with seven stations, namely Janpath, Mandi House, ITO, Delhi Gate, Jama Masjid, Lal Qila and Kashmiri Gate. Though this corridor was shortest in length, it turned out to be a major engineering challenge for Delhi Metro. Heritage Line Challenges. As DMRC embarked upon this tough section, numerous challenges were waiting on the way.
We faced a number of technical challenges in Heritage Line. First one was about the TBM. We had predicted certain strata after doing geotechnical investigation, but the strata at site was entirely different. And at number of places, we had a mixed strata, half face rock and half face soil. And because of this unpredictable strata, one of our TBM actually failed. Further, while making cross passages, we had challenges because of the very high water table there. In fact, at one of the locations, we could not complete the cross passes because of the ingress of very high water. And we had to finally abandon the cross passage and provide alternate escape shaft.
DMRC had to encounter many such engineering challenges which were not anticipated during the planning stages. As soon as the construction work started on Heritage Line, many complexities surfaced which tested the abilities of engineers. But the DMRC engineers were prepared to tackle them one after another. Hard rock in the way. The engineers encountered their first challenge on ITO Delhi Gate section. It was the presence of the 16th century old historical monument Khuni Darwaza, constructed by Sher Shah Suri, the then ruler of Delhi. Since the tunnel was passing close to this monument, DMRC conducted 24 hours real-time monitoring during tunneling in that area.
The Heritage Line provided a lot of challenges for the Delhi Metro Rail Corporation in Phase 3. It was going through a very old part of the city, the walled city of Delhi. There were a number of structures which were heritage in nature. They were very old. They had very weak foundations, so we had to be very careful during the construction. We had to take necessary approvals from the ASI, all the government regulations which were there that had to be followed during our construction.
On the ITO Delhi Gate section, construction was underway in full swing, and DMRC was strictly following the guidelines prescribed by the National Monuments Authority, as the monument was in close proximity of the construction area. Here, the TBM on the upline encountered hard rock, and it stopped as the TBM was originally designed for soft soil. Presence of such hard rock was not anticipated here. Now, it was time for the engineers to explore some other solutions to overcome the situation. DMRC then employed a pipe pushing technique. In this technique, two pipes of 1800 dia each were inserted from the Delhi Gate shaft towards the stuck TBM. Construction worker was sent through these pipes inside the tunnel to break away the rock slowly and make way for the TBM to move forward. Given the challenges it posed to DMRC engineers, the Delhi Gate Jama Masjid section can be called the stretch of challenges. As the work proceeded on this stretch, DMRC engineers were welcomed by a major hurdle in the very beginning. DMRC tunnel had to pass close to the Sunehri Masjid monument, which again is a heritage site. The ability to keep the circumstances under control enables us to overcome toughest challenges in any situation. As we overcome one challenge, another challenge was ready to test the patience of meritorious engineers of DMRC. And this second challenge was encountered when DMRC came upon the ruins of an old structure called the Akbarabadi Mosque while tunneling beneath Subhash Park. On 6th July 2012, while digging earth in Netaji Subhash Park area to construct a metro station, the DMRC came across remains of some medieval era construction buried under the ground. The discovery triggered excitement among local residents, who believed the remains to belong to Akbarabadi Masjid. DMRC decided to shift its alignment from that area. The area has now been taken over by the Supreme Court and has been sealed. The Jama Masjid station was shifted 45 meters laterally and 75 meters longitudinally. The tunnel length was also laterally increased by 72 meters on both the tunnels. Now DMRC had to fight another battle due to the change of alignment, which led to many changes in a very crucial time. The new alignment differed from the alignment mentioned in the original contract. The soil investigations and the geotechnical surveys had already been done by DMRC for the original alignment. Now, because of this shifting, DMRC engineers had to carry out construction in unfamiliar territory. The alignment had now to be shifted under the busy Netaji Subhash Marg, and a major portion of the tunnels were to be dug beneath the densely populated residential area of Daryaganj. Shifting the alignment caused numerous unwanted problems, as the earlier alignment was passing under a non-residential stretch of open space. DMRC engineers did not have access to the ground because the area was densely populated and housed very old buildings and structures, mostly in dilapidated conditions. None of these complications could stop DMRC, and in the end, they overcame the complications despite facing numerous difficulties. The Delhi Gate Jama Masjid stretch is not only known for challenges but also for extraordinary feats. One such feat was achieved when the complete TBM assembly was done at one go inside the tunnel for the upline. It was 96 meters long, completely assembled underground tunnel boring machine, or TBM. This was the longest TBM ever used in Delhi Metro project and weighed approximately 500 tons. The first tunneling obstacle of phase 3 was also witnessed with this TBM. The TBM initially encountered hard rock, but after 35 rings had been completed, the TBM encountered an old well adjacent to Kasturba Gandhi Hospital in October 2013. This sudden change in ground parameters and settlement values led to a chimney-like formation, which led to a 172 cubic meter cavity from the ground level. DMRC engineers acted quickly, and this issue was resolved within 24 hours. But after crossing the hospital, the TBM stopped as its bearings failed. Once a TBM gets stuck in such a scenario, it is extremely difficult to move it. The only way to retrieve it is to make a shaft after thoroughly studying the surface. During the construction work, every TBM was given a number, and everyone would recognize the TBM by its number only. The TBM-3 remained stuck at this point for almost 2 years. And the TBM-3, which was stuck on the upline, could complete around 50% tunneling. The cutter head of the TBM was badly damaged due to the rock encountered on the way. Originally, only one TBM was to be used for constructing both the tunnels. But finally, a total of 3 TBMs had to be used to complete the tunneling between Delhi Gate and Jama Masjid.
Many areas in old Delhi, like Jama Masjid, Delhi Gate area, and also in Azadpur area, where it was not possible to do detailed soil investigation in advance. And the machinery which were deployed there, particularly the tunnel boring machines, they were designed to suit the information available. But when we went actually there, the things were different, the geology was different. And at two locations, one between Delhi Gate and Jama Masjid, and another one between Azadpur and Mukundpur, the machines were stuck up. And here again, we had to do the midway correction, change the design, change the sequence, created mid-shaft there. Those machines were taken out. The new machines were lowered from those. So this was all done to suit the particular conditions. And here our experience of phase one and phase two really helped in a big way.
Construction of the shaft near Golcha Cinema Hall was a mammoth task in itself. Golcha Cinema is located in Daryaganj, an extremely congested and heavily populated area with large volume of traffic. Special traffic permissions had to be taken to dig the shaft at Golcha Cinema. The digging of this shaft took around 4 to 5 months. DMRC had to work cautiously while digging the shaft because a lot of utilities like water lines, sewer lines, and telecom lines were encountered, some of which had to be shifted to dig the shaft. On 9th February 2016, water started filling the Golcha shaft because an 1800 dia sewer line got damaged. But it was not the end of the challenges. Now, DMRC had to tackle a grave problem of settlement, which happened at the site in February 2016. A 500-ton crane tilted. To remove this crane, one smaller crane of 150-ton was brought, because of which the road going from Delhi Gate to Jama Masjid had to be closed for the traffic. The traffic going towards Jama Masjid was diverted towards Ring Road with the help of the Delhi Traffic Police. The 500-ton crane was dismantled and removed from the site, and the road was restored the same day. Finally, the tunnel breakthrough for TBM-3 took place on 21st March 2016, and it was retrieved through a special shaft constructed at Golcha on 21st March 2016. Evacuation woes. DMRC team was relieved a bit, but they also knew the battle is not won yet, and this was not the end of their difficulties. On every step, a new challenge was unfolding, and this time, evacuation of local residents of Daryaganj was a Herculean task. Daryaganj is a neighborhood of Delhi inside the walled city of Old Delhi. Daryaganj is one of the 3 subdivisions of Central Delhi district. It started at Delhi Gate, at the edge of Netaji Subhash Road, which goes towards Red Fort. The old Daryaganj area houses a number of dilapidated buildings and structures, and DMRC had to put up vertical supports in all structures during the tunneling process. People also had to be evacuated from these buildings in a phase-wise manner as precautionary measure. The first area to be evacuated were David Street, Gopal Mandir and Kucha Parmanand. These people had to be evacuated twice during the tunneling on both the tunnels. A total of 2,000 people were evacuated, with around 650 people evacuated in one go. They were accommodated in various guest houses situated in the nearby areas, and DMRC paid for their lodging and food expenses. DMRC also repaired and restored their houses before shifting the residents back.
We had to ensure that there is no disruption to the citizens over there. We had to move some people from their residences into hotels. Commercial establishments, we had to provide at all times access for the public so that the business could continue. We used a number of tunnel boring machines, much more than what we had originally anticipated. Because while we were doing tunneling in this area, we came across some unexpected soil strata. So some additional machines had to be deployed and some of the old machines had to be repaired. All this called for a lot of interaction with all the local people in the area. We were constantly keeping them abreast of the developments, and we got good cooperation also from them. Rules, regulations, everything had to be followed to the hilt since we were passing through such an important part of the city. All this required a lot of planning, lot of monitoring, and a number of methods were utilized to ensure this.
Triple interchange at Kashmiri Gate. The Kashmiri Gate metro station with three interchanges is one of the biggest interchange stations of the Delhi metro network. At the Kashmiri Gate station, people are able to travel between Raja Nahar Singh in Ballabgarh via Faridabad and Shaheed Sthal Ghaziabad ISBT to Rithala and Huda City Centre to Samaipur Badli, as it is an interchange for three corridors, red, yellow and violet lines. The station is the first model of multimodal integration, or MMI, in Delhi, where three links connect at the concourse level. The Kashmiri Gate metro station services the historic area of Delhi. This giant station is very close to ISBT, or Interstate Bus Terminal, having interstate and local bus stands and metro stations connecting almost every part of the city and further connecting it with Faridabad in Haryana and Ghaziabad in UP. Kashmiri Gate station has proved to be a boon for travellers, especially for NCR passengers, which helped to cut travel time to and fro from many places. The station is also located very close to the Old Delhi Railway Station of the Northern Railway, one of the oldest and busiest markets in Old Delhi, like Chandni Chowk, Chowri Bazaar, Sadar Bazaar and many more. This stretch has also passed beneath a number of heritage structures and historical monuments like Kashmiri Gate Monument, St. James Church, Dara Shikoh Library, Lothia Bridge, Delhi Shahadra Northern Railway Line, the Grand Post Office, Magazine Gate and Ambedkar University. The initial plan for the new station was overlapping on the existing station, and it was thus decided to shift the alignment so that the existing station would not be disturbed. The second challenge came during construction of the reversal facility for metro trains was planned. A part of Palna, an orphanage in the area, was to be partially disrupted. As initially, the plan was to use cut and cover technique for the reversal tunnel. But in order to avoid disturbing the orphanage, only 110 meters of the reversal was constructed using the cut and cover, while 220 meters had to be constructed using the new Austrian tunneling method, or NATM, which was not originally planned. Since the existing station could not be disturbed, the new station had to be curved at the platform level. The radius of the curve is 1000 meters. And due to this, the downline is curved while the upline is straight. Because of the same reason, the platform of the new station is also tapered. The width of the platform at the south end, that is Lal Killa side, is 14 meters, and it narrows down at the north end to 8.5 meters. The new station connected to the existing station at four levels, three at underground levels, and one at the elevated concourse of the existing station with the concourse of the new station with an escalator. Contractor trouble. There are times when contractors fail to complete projects, and this played a major role in delaying the section. Despite having maximum number of challenges in this stretch of phase 3, DMRC succeeded and somehow managed to beat the odds with capable and bright leadership of the top management as well as engineers. Central Secretariat Mandi House was opened for the public on 26th June 2014 and between Mandi House and ITO on 8th June 2015. The trial runs on the Delhi Gate Kashmiri Gate section began on 10th August 2016. After obtaining all necessary clearances for opening of this section, DMRC made a major foray into the walled city of the national capital as the ITO Kashmiri Gate Heritage Line was thrown open to public on 28th May 2017. Now, commuters are experiencing the charm of Old Delhi while taking a ride on the Heritage Corridor. Magenta Line, Janakpuri West Botanical Garden. Delhi needs more metro services considering the fact that most of the population rely on metro. Hence, Delhi Metro's planning experts felt that the network was still insufficient to cater to the requirements of this ever-expanding urban agglomerate. The Janakpuri West Botanical Garden Corridor, color-coded magenta, is the Delhi Metro's new corridor along the city's outer ring road. It goes through Dabri, Dashrathpuri, Palam, Sadar Bazar, domestic terminals of the Indira Gandhi International Airport, etc. to reach Vasant Vihar in South Delhi. From here, the corridor hits the outer ring road of the city and covers prominent localities such as Munirka, R.K. Puram, IIT, Hauz Khas, Panchshil Park, Chirag Delhi, Greater Kailash, Nehru Enclave along the arterial road. The corridor then enters Jamia Nagar to finally connect with the Botanical Garden station of Blue Line after crossing the Yamuna. This 38.23 kilometer long corridor is extremely crucial from the point of view of connectivity because it covers a number of prominent landmarks along the way. The domestic terminal of the Indira Gandhi International Airport has got metro connectivity for the first time and provided much needed relief to the domestic flyers of the city. The corridor also covered prominent educational institutions of the city such as the Indian Institute of Technology, IIT, Jamia Millia Islamia University and Amity University, Noida. The corridor has four interchange stations in Janakpuri West, Hauz Khas, Kalkaji Mandir and Botanical Garden, which connected it with the already operational blue, yellow and violet lines of the Delhi Metro network. Hauz Khas, Delhi Metro's underground wonder. DMRC has achieved numerous milestones while constructing its Phase 3 project. During the construction of the Hauz Khas Metro Station, the Delhi Metro turned one of the major obstructions into an engineering wonder by creating a network of criss-cross underground tunnels. Any construction work underground is always an engineering challenge. And Hauz Khas was going to have interchange facility. The engineers also had to ensure that the interconnectivity between the old yellow line Samaipur Badli to Huda city centre and the new portion of the Hauz Khas station should be seamless and comfortable. The new tunnel had to pass below an already functional metro tunnel. And all this had to be achieved without hampering passenger services even for an hour on the yellow line.
Our line 8 at Hauz Khas station is crossing the existing yellow line. So there is a yellow line having a station, and we were supposed to construct a new interchange station also very close to the existing yellow line station. So due to the presence of the two tunnels already which were operational, our tunnels have to cross below them, and about 4.9 meter gap was maintained below the existing tunnels.
To further add to the woes was the busy outer ring road running adjacent to the construction area. Being one of Delhi's arterial roads, thousands of vehicles use the road every hour, and it was absolutely impossible to stop or divert traffic on such a busy road even for short durations. Construction work below the surface requires precision in planning and absolute competence in execution, since even a minor error or oversight on the part of the engineers may lead to disastrous results.
After considering different alternatives, it is found that going below the existing line was good option. So we have adopted it. If we construct above the lines, this will come exposed on the ground. And after the station, there was a building area. It was not possible to go below the building area.
The yellow line station at Hauskas is 17 meters deep. For the construction of the new station, it was not possible to go below the existing station, as the foundation is 32 meters deep, and there is the foundation of the flyover on Outer Ring Road as well. Therefore, if the new station had to be constructed below the existing station, we would have to go deep up to about 42 meters, which would have been very difficult. So, the new station has been built adjacent to the existing station at a depth of 29 meters with a length of 265 meters. It has been designed as a five-level station: rail, platform, intermediate, concourse. Generally, interchange stations have three or in some cases four levels only.
Because of the 30-meter depth of the station, we had several levels. So, in the top-down methodology, we do the top slab, basically, the roof slab. And we leave the cutouts in that slab, and through that, we start the further excavation. And as the excavation progresses, we lower the machinery at the bottom level, and then we do the intermediate slabs. And then one by one, the levels are achieved. So, basically, apart from the roof slab and the base slab, it has a one concourse slab and three intermediate slabs are there. Taking out of the soil was a very big challenge, 30 meter height. So we have to bring the soil from the bottommost level to the next level and then again rehandle the soil. So in three stages, we have to rehandle the soil till it comes out of the station up to the top level.
Hauskas Interchange Station in many ways reflects the tremendous construction challenges that DMRC's engineers have faced in carrying out the underground construction work of Phase 3.
The D-wall of the station was just in front of the Sarprevar apartments. So, during construction, we had to take extra precaution that there is no settlement in the existing houses. So, we have installed the tilt meters and the crack meters and also the settlement markers on all these buildings, and they were periodically monitored so that there is no danger to the safety of the houses. And with the safety, we could complete this work.
Now, the approximate time to commute between Huda City Centre and Botanical Garden is about 50 minutes. Metro's intelligent tunnelling to pass below elevated viaduct of Kashmiri Gate Raja Nahar Singh in Ballabgarh. Underground construction is always having its challenges. However, DMRC's engineers showed great commitment and presence of mind in ensuring the work could be completed without any major hindrance. DMRC has used the new Austrian tunneling method, NATM, to carry out tunneling work between Kalkaji Mandir and NSIC Okhla on this corridor, to pass below the Nehru Place to Kalkaji elevated section of the Kashmiri Gate to Raja Nahar Singh Ballabgarh Metro Corridor, the Violet Line. The tunnel between Kalkaji Mandir and NSIC Okhla passes below piers 135 and 136 of the Violet Line. It would have been impossible to construct twin tunnels with such a short space. Therefore, a decision was taken to construct a single tube twin tunnel through which both the tracks could pass using the NATM technology.
Just before the Kalkaji station, the line from Botanical Garden side was elevated, and we were to have the first station at Kalkaji as underground station. And we were crossing the existing Line 6 viaduct outside the Kalkaji Mandir station. And before entering into the station area, our tunnels were very close to the Lotus Temple as well as the Kalkaji Mandir. The biggest challenge there was that hard rock was encountered, and it was difficult to excavate that, and due to the issue of vibration and noise problem, we were not allowed to do any control blasting, or even heavy duty breakers were not allowed. So what innovation we did was that we procured lot of rock splitters. So rock splitter is an equipment which will create minimum vibration in the rock when it will break it, and subsequently that rock can be removed easily by the small breakers and the excavators.
The NATM tunnel is 176 meters long and is placed between the Kalkaji Mandir and the NSIC Okhla metro stations. The average depth of the tunnel is 20.5 meters from the ground level. The finished dia of the tunnel is 10.7 meters. It is a single tube twin tunnel through which both the tracks are passing. The crown level of the tunnel excavation is approximately 9.4 meters below the base of the piers. For passing below the piers, specially designed custom-made bolts were installed which held the soil.
TBM is a very easy and very confident procedure to do the tunneling, but due to restriction of piers of the Line 6, it was not possible to execute tunneling from Kalkaji to Okhla NSIC through TBM. Hence, it was decided the tunnel will be constructed by using new Austin tunneling method.
In DMRC, NATM had been used earlier in phase 2 and in phase 3. NATM had also been used at Kashmiri Gate. In the present era, NATM is generally used in areas where tunneling through tunnel boring machines is not possible. NATM technology involves tunneling through mechanical excavation or controlled blasting. In this method, initially the earth is excavated and a primary lining of hotcrete, steel or lattice girders, wire mesh and rock bolts are applied for stabilization of soil as per geological strata. Here, M25 spray concrete has been used in the process. Later, a final concrete lining using M40 grade of concrete was done, which was 400 mm in depth. Every movement of the surface during excavation was measured using sophisticated instruments such as inclinometer, extensometer, load cell, etc. Delhi Metro's use of the NATM technology at Kalkaji Mandir is a classic example of intelligent tunneling by the Delhi Metro's engineers. Since it was a small stretch which had to pass below already operational viaducts, this decision to go for NATM technology was taken, which helped DMRC in completing the work within schedule. Domestic airport enters Metro Map. One of the great benefits of Delhi Metro's Phase 3 is that the domestic terminals of the Indira Gandhi Airport has also got metro connectivity, a requirement often felt by the city's domestic air passengers. The Airport Express Link provides metro connectivity to the new T3 terminal of the airport, from which all international carriers and all premium domestic airlines fly. The Terminal 1, Indira Gandhi International Airport Metro Station, is an underground station which has come up on the Janakpuri West Kalindi Kunj Botanical Garden Corridor. Interchanges on this corridor: Janakpuri West with Line 3, Hauz Khas with Line 2, Kalkaji Mandir with Line 6, Botanical Garden with Line 3.
During planning of this station was giving seamless connectivity of this station with airport, because mostly the passengers were carrying heavy baggages along with them, those who are coming from airport to the metro station and vice versa. So for that we have given seamless connectivity also by making one tunnel from metro station to airport.
The Terminal 1 IGI Airport station also stands out for its engineering achievements. It has a number of landmarks, making it one of the most unique stations of Metro's third phase of expansion. The station has reversal facility for trains, so that trains can be reversed from this station to facilitate better frequency of trains. The station box is among the longest, with a length of 312.2 meters. Normally, underground stations are around 260 meters. Depth of the station is approximately 16 meters. The station has 5 entry exit points. Design of the station. The station has a bright interior with the use of granite stone, stainless steel finishes, colorful pattern with ceramic tiles. These tiles are easy to maintain and add color to the finishes. They are also readily available in the market in different patterns and sizes.
We were constructing this particular metro station adjoining to the airport. So we were supposed to maintain similar or better than the airport ambience, and we could achieve this environment by giving a fantastic artwork that is really worth watching.
Engineering challenges. DMRC's engineers encountered hard rock during the excavation for this station. However, on one side of the site was the busy Terminal 1 of the IGI airport, and on the other was the congested Mehram Nagar locality, which had a number of buildings in precarious condition.
Mehram Nagar village was very close to the IGI station, our underground station construction, and the people adjoining, people living in that area were very, very apprehensive during our construction period. Initially, it was very non-cooperative approach from their side, but later on, they realized what we are doing is good for them in future, and later on we got good support from them also.
Controlled blasting was carried out at the site, and various monitoring equipment were installed to check the condition of the nearby buildings. The operations or traffic flow at the nearby airport terminal was not allowed to be hampered even for a day.
The soil was very hard, it was on hard rock. And we were supposed to work there in a very, very safe conditions, maintaining surrounding area safety on top priority. Because during this entire construction, we have never ever stopped airport traffic movement. So we were supposed to give them hindrance-free movement.
Delhi Metro's bridge over Yamuna. DMRC built a bridge on the river Yamuna with a span of 574 meters, which connects Delhi with Noida, is one of a kind. This is the fourth bridge constructed on the river between Kalindi Kunj and the Okhla Bird Sanctuary Metro Station. And what makes the bridge unique is the challenging working condition. Delhi Metro could carry out construction work only during dry winter months, since water is released from Okhla Barrage every few hours. This was Delhi Metro's first ever bridge over Yamuna, which directly connects Delhi with Noida, since it is placed exactly on the Delhi-Uttar Pradesh border. The approximate length of this bridge is about 574 meters. The bridge has 14 spans of 41 meters length each and 15 piers. This bridge has come up about 85 meters downstream of the existing Okhla Bridge over the river Yamuna. During construction work, on many occasions, water was released from barrage at short notices, leaving DMRC with very little time to wrap up work there. Within hours, all workers and heavy equipment had to be removed from the site as water would start rising following the release from the barrage. This caused substantial loss of man hours. In addition, during monsoons, due to rising water levels, it was very difficult to carry on with the construction, and substantial work could be done only during the dry months. Land acquisition challenge at Kalindi Kunj Depot. About 22.5 hectares of land was requisitioned for the construction of the depot, out of which about 50% only could become available. Since the available land was insufficient to construct all the major components of the depot, a decision was taken to construct elevated decks in Jasola Vihar to stable the trains. A 1.3 kilometer long and 30 to 40 meters wide deck for stabling lines has been constructed at Jasola Vihar near Kalindi Kunj on an elevated deck about 13 to 14 meters from the ground, where the trains operating on this section are stable.
Because of the non-availability of sufficient land, some of the depots were constructed in parts, like Vinod Nagar depot or Kalindi Kunj depot, where the project could not get sufficient land at one place. So the depot was split into two parts. The management of this kind of depots was never done in earlier phases.
The pink line, that is Line 7, constructed as part of the Delhi Metro Phase 3 network. It consists of 38 metro stations from Majlis Park to Shiv Vihar, out of which 12 stations are underground and 26 stations are elevated. The pink line, with a length of 59 kilometers, is the longest individual line in Delhi Metro. It is mostly elevated and covers Delhi in an almost U-shaped pattern. The pink line is also known as the Ring Road line, as the entire line passes alongside the busy Ring Road in Delhi that witnesses massive traffic volumes every day. The corridor connects important landmarks such as Shalimar Bagh, Shakurpur, Punjabi Bagh, Narayana, Dhola Kua, Moti Bagh, South Extension, Lajpat Nagar, Ashram, Hazrat Nizamuddin, Mayur Vihar, Trilokpuri, Vinod Nagar, Welcome, Maujpur and Shiv Vihar. On this corridor, stations have been planned on the basis of the norms and criteria already adopted in Phase 1 and Phase 2 corridors. Traffic integration facilities have been provided at almost all the stations, keeping in view the ridership pattern and availability of land. The integration facilities at metro stations include approach roads to the stations, circulation facilities, pedestrian ways and adequate areas for various modes likely to come to important stations, including feeder buses or minibuses. Vinod Nagar Depot, Majlis Park to Shiv Vihar Corridor. DMRC has proven itself by beating every challenge over time, and one such example is the Vinod Nagar Depot, where DMRC again proved its competence. DMRC's Vinod Nagar Depot is first depot in India constructed as double-storey depot. This depot has been planned and constructed in very compact manner within a land of 19.9 hectares. Initially, this depot was planned as a normal depot on ground. This depot is also designed for the maintenance of stabling of trains which run on UTO mode. DDA allotted 19.90 hectare land at Vinod Nagar Depot in two parts separated by the Shahadra drain approximately 150 meters apart. The site towards Delhi is called Site 1 and the one towards Ghaziabad is Site 2. Both the sites have been joined with a special type of structure constructed using the balanced cantilever construction method. Earlier, the major facilities were planned at Site 1 with technical and administrative buildings. DDA withdrew 3 hectare land from Site 1 for allotment to other department.
This Vinod Nagar depot is a very unique depot constructed in Phase 3, and it is a double deck depot constructed first in India. This depot has been constructed in a very compact manner, considering all the environmental issues.
Hence, a double-deck stabling building was planned to accommodate the trains. This depot is equipped with 4 inspection bay lines, 2 workshop lines, a depot control center and test tracks. Site 2 is planned at 2 levels, partly low level and partly at higher ground level. Inspection bay lines, or IBL, and a workshop has been constructed on the upper ground level. 32 train stabling facilities have been provided in the depot. Facilities for 12 trains open stabling at Site 1 and 20 trains covered stabling in double deck has been provided. The lower deck has been provided with 9 stabling and 2 shunting necks. The upper deck has been provided with 11 stabling lines. Double deck stabling has been structurally designed with 4 floors for future property development above the building. Stilt has been provided for 600 car parking provision for future property development. A 652-meter test track has been designed partly on a structure and partly on earth. Dhola Kuan, the new height of success. DMRC reached its highest point so far at 23.6 meters after the construction of a viaduct between the Durgabhai Deshmukh South Campus and Delhi Cant Metro stations. The viaduct is part of the 59-kilometer-long Majlis Park Shiv Vihar corridor of Delhi Metro's Phase 3. It crosses over the existing alignment of the Airport Express line at Dhola Kuan.
Line 7 construction is at fourth level at this stage. At first level, there is a ring road. Second level is SP road. Third level is the running Airport Express line. And fourth is the line which was under construction. So that means the level of the fourth line was around 23.6 meter, as high as 8-story building. And this was to be crossed by a launcher. The launcher height was around 31 meter above this.
The height of the viaduct at Dhola Kuan is 23.6 meters, and it is the highest point of Delhi Metro so far, surpassing Karkarduma, where the metro passes at a height of 19 meters above the ground. Some of the stretches on the Majlis Park Shiv Vihar corridor have been deliberately kept elevated, as an underground line would have created a lot of traffic diversions. The metro viaduct between the South Campus and Delhi Cant metro stations, which crosses over the existing alignment of the Airport Express line at Dhola Kuan, was a major engineering achievement for the Delhi Metro, as the viaduct was constructed without hampering movement of trains on the airport line and the road traffic movement on Ring Road Sardar Patel Marg below.
Because of the heavy traffic, the workers were not able to cross the road and enter into the workplace. So, after a lot of deliberation with all stakeholders, the safety department of DMRC, we proposed that the workers should be taken in a bus and take them into the workplace. So, one space was identified and the workers were carried by a bus. But that was not over. Once we have taken the workers inside the workplace, they were supposed to be there for 8 hours. So, all facilities were created, like toilets, restroom, canteen, all basic facilities were made available.
Planning stage of building a viaduct at Dhola Kuan was tough, but the trickiest part was the execution of the plan. The launching operation above the airport line was done only during the non-operating hours, that is, between 12:30 a.m. till 4 a.m. to avoid any disruption to the traffic on the airport line. During this time, no activities for train operations were permitted on that portion of the Airport Express line. Launching work started only after receiving all clearances from Operation and Maintenance, that is O&M department of the airport line. All the parts of the launcher were earthed before commencing the work. A diversion road was also constructed to ensure that there was no inconvenience caused to the road users during erection. The design team of DMRC also prepared the design of the viaduct after closely studying the requirement of passing over several major landmarks, such as the airport line viaduct and the flyover at such a height. As per the design, 3 spans of 37 meters were made by segmental box girder technique by the launcher above the existing Airport Express line. A span of 37 meters has 13 segments weighing 45 tons each on an average, which means each span of 37 meters has a weight of 585 tons and the weight of the launcher is 350 tons.
It was a segmental construction. So 13 segments of weight ranging from 30 ton to 40 ton were to be erected.
Due to the close proximity with the existing flyover and the airport line viaduct, and as the segments were to be lifted to a height of about 23 meters, a systematic methodology was planned for the erection of the segments. The segments were erected through a special four-step method because of the extra height involved. Step 1. The trailer brought the segment and was parked between the already constructed piers. Step 2. The segment was lifted by an extended winch assembly having a load carrying capacity of 120 tons, whereas the maximum weight of any segment is 55 tons, and transfer of the same to the extended McAlloy bars extended by couplers as the normal arrangement of winch and McAlloy bars fixed to a slider can launch the segment only up to 15 meter height. Then the segment was transferred to a normal winch assembly, and the extended McAlloy bar was removed and again lifted to a height so that could be transferred to the McAlloy bars fixed to the slider. Step 3. The segment was rotated and attached with a segment trolley or slider using 440 mm dia McAlloy bars having a capacity of 129 tons. Step 4. The segment trolley or slider was pushed to one end of the pier where it had erected through a segment launcher. Then the gluing of the segments was carried out, followed by stressing. Tunneling between Majlis Park and Azadpur. Majlis Park is the first station of the Pink Corridor, which is the longest individual corridor of Delhi Metro. Azadpur Station is another important underground station on this corridor, as it provides interchange facility with the existing yellow corridor of the DMRC network. The tunneling between Majlis Park and Azadpur was quite challenging. After completing 580 rings from Azadpur towards the Majlis Park ramp at a depth of 21 meters at their low point, tunnel boring machines TBM engaged to make the 1.4 kilometer long tunnel encountered unexpected ground conditions while tunneling in this stretch. The unexpected ground conditions damaged the cutter heads of both the TBMs during the tunneling, and it was not possible to change the damaged cutter heads of the TBM under the ground. The TBM not designed for such rock mass conditions.
The tunneling between the Azadpur and Majlis Park, which is 1.4 kilometer, two TBM of soil only was launched from Azadpur by making launching shaft at Azadpur, and it continued 700 meter. Now suddenly after 700 meter, the two TBM struck in the rock mass, and as a result it was very difficult to take out, to move further I can say. And that rock mass, just above the rock mass there was a Gurdwara and two buildings were there.
Thus, an emergency shaft had to be made midway to retrieve the TBMs in the densely populated colony of North Delhi. Land on the surface to build the shaft was not available, as this area had a number of private residents and a Gurudwara. It took a lot of careful effort, planning and persuasion to convince these occupants to agree for temporary relocation, demolition and reconstruction, which was all necessary to build the shaft in this area, so that the whole TBM, length 7 meters, could be retrieved from the top. The retrieval and relocation. Under these circumstances, DMRC took a decision to retrieve the TBMs instead of changing the cutter heads, and for this purpose, two houses of 110 square meter area each and another structure of 400 square meter were taken to make the retrieval shaft. Once the residents were relocated to an alternate location and the land was acquired from the concerned owners, the demolition work began. The rescue shaft was designed with secant piles, which were placed in the periphery of the shaft. Secant pile is a continuous series of primary or plane and secondary or reinforced piles. Primary piles are installed first with secondary piles constructed in between primary piles with an overlap of 200 mm on each side. During the boring of piles, surrounding buildings were closely monitored by soil settlement markers, building settlement points, extensiometer, real-time online monitoring, etc. Meanwhile, two rock TBMs were started from the Majlis Park side towards Azadpur so that the tunneling process could be completed in this section. After completing the tunneling process, these TBMs were also retrieved from the same shaft at Rameshwar Nagar. During excavation of the shaft below the water table, that is 6 meters, multiple problems were faced, like frequent incidents of water or soil ingress inside the shaft, leading to settlement in surrounding areas, gantry foundation and buildings.
Only the option left after value engineering was to convert this shaft into a retrieval shaft and a later part into emergency shaft. The TBMs were taken out from the Gurdwara after dismantling the Gurdwara and two buildings. Further, two TBMs were sourced from other contractor and they started tunneling from the other end, this Majlis Park. In this way, this challenge was overtaken.
Design of Ashram Station. Constructing the Ashram Metro Station on Pink Line was not an easy task due to various reasons. With a size of just 151.6 meters against an average of 265 meters, Ashram Station is one of the smallest metro stations in the world. This underground station is located at the center of one of the busiest intersections in the city, and DMRC had to fight several land acquisition battles. The long-lasting legal battle forced the designers to come up with a station design that took just 151.6 meters of space against the average of 265 meters.
This station was very typically located. We take about 265 meter length for a typical station. But here we had to accommodate our station within the 151.9 meter.
Since the private land could not be acquired, the DMRC had to reduce the station space by almost half the average size. Constructing the Ashram Station in available land was not an easy task. This also forced the engineers to rethink the architecture of the station.
That by the time the new act came into force, in relation to the land acquisition, and many of the provisions of land acquisitions of the new act were very, I'll say, cumbersome, lengthy, and also this required a lot of machinery to be developed on the part of the state government. And these facilities were not available, and therefore this was another big challenge. Therefore, we had to do many innovative midway correction, both in terms of design and also land acquisition. At many locations, we had to resort to the change in the design. For example, Ashram Station, where the land was one big issue.
DMRC architects and engineers, for the first time, completely redesigned the underground station, utilizing all three levels, that is, the mezzanine, concourse, and platform, to accommodate all the essential equipment which are generally placed only at concourse and platform levels of underground stations. This was done by reducing the length of the platform, relocating ticket counters and automatic fare collection gates, and shifting of ancillary buildings and ventilation fan rooms vertically upwards. DMRC thus ensured that despite less space, the commuters got the same facilities and quality of service.
There was another challenge for the Ashram Station. We electrical engineers, in coordination with civil engineers, totally gone for innovative design adjustment of equipments in the station, and we were able to do so.
The length of the platform for a typical 6-car train is 140 meters. At this station, the length of the platform was reduced to 135 meters, which is just enough to ensure clear 3 meters width in front of the passenger doors as well as the driver cabin door of the rolling stock. Crossing the railway station at Anand Vihar. The Line 7 of Delhi Metro has faced the maximum number of engineering challenges since it passed through a lot of difficult stretches and densely populated areas. One such section was the portion when the viaduct had to cross the Anand Vihar railway station of the Indian Railways, one of the busiest stations in terms of ridership and number of trains. For crossing this area of Indian Railways, 6 piers were erected in the railway compound in such a way that there was no infringement of the metro line with the railways. One of the spans, which is designed between pier number 235 and 236, is almost 70 meters long. In order to cater to the requirement of special spans, cellular lightweight concrete or CLC construction has been done with the help of bridge builders.
A lot of safety measures were taken. All steel parts of the bridge builder were earthed properly. When we were moving the bridge builder, the clearance between the OHE wire and the bottom of the bridge builder was 800 mm only, and it was very risky, but it was adequately planned and all safety measures were taken. We did the complete work without any power block.
DMRC has crossed the railway lines in a very safe and systematic manner, with all safety precautions in place and without affecting the daily train movement on the section in coordination with the Indian Railways. The work was done only after obtaining the necessary approval from the Commissioner for Metro Rail Safety, that is CMRS.
CLC is generally a proven technique for construction of a long span bridges, and generally it's for a straight span. But the challenge was that our viaduct is having a curvature of 5.6 degree with a gradient of 3.6%. Hence, after casting of every segment by a bridge builder, we have to ensure, doubly ensure, that the casting of a segment is along the line of the designated alignment.
Phase 3 metro trains lowered on tracks. To expedite the process of conducting trial runs on the Janakpuri West Terminal 1 IGI Airport section of the Magenta Line, the Delhi Metro unloaded the first 6 coach train of this section on the tracks with the help of cranes and trailers in December 2016. The 6 coach train was unloaded on the ramp near Sadar Bazar Metro Station through a carefully planned operation, in which the coaches were lowered near the ramp, the location where the alignment goes underground from elevated. The process needed absolute precision to avoid any physical damage to the coaches or the civil structure. The decision to unload the train was taken to ensure the timely beginning of trial runs on this particular section. This step has helped a lot in expediting the commissioning of services on this line, since the communication-based train control or CBTC technology has been implemented for the first time. The commissioning time for signalling took longer, and hence it was decided to take up commissioning work in multiple sections side by side. Communication-based train control. The new signalling technology known as communication-based train control or CBTC has been implemented after undergoing rigorous testing in stages. By means of the CBTC systems, the exact position of a train is known more accurately than with the traditional signalling systems. This results in a more efficient and safe way to manage the railway traffic. Metros and other railway systems are able to improve headways while maintaining or even improving safety.
The main advantage of the system is that it provides moving blocks, which in turn gives a shorter headway as compared to the conventional fixed block system. Secondly, less number of trackside equipments are required to be installed. As far as cost is concerned, per kilometer cost of CBTC system is also less than the fixed block system. CBTC technology is also ready to include future grade of automation, that is UTO.
Keeping the Delhi Metro running all day long without a glitch requires not only regular maintenance of trains and tracks, but also constant monitoring of the system during operational hours. The response of the train at different speeds, braking of the train, and the interconnection with the Operations Control Center, or OCC, was also monitored during the trials. The behavior of the track system and the overhead electrification, or OHE, was checked repeatedly.
We had also gone for new technology in overhead equipment, our traction system. In some of the sections, we tried new and better technology, like one section we tried for single insulator cantilever, in which the maintenance is very less.
Delhi Metro was conceived to alleviate traffic congestion in the city, providing the commuters with a faster and eco-friendly transportation alternative.
It was the first time we had to commission these 100 odd stations in a period of 1 year. So that is most challenging as far as operations is concerned, because for these stations we had to train station controllers, train operators, customer care assistants and customer relation assistants. So it was an onerous task. In fact, there were new systems coming up, signaling systems, for which we had to even make training manuals and also set up the training schedules.
Rolling stock. Today, Delhi Metro is the busiest rapid transit system in India, connecting the country's capital region. Rolling stock is the most important aspect of any rail network, and the rolling stock acquired for Phase 3 were loaded with many new features, especially in its interior and exterior from the aesthetic as well as commuter facility points of view. The very first change was done in its look of the front cab of the train, and a glass was added on the front emergency door, which completely transformed the look and feel of the train. LED-based lighting has been used inside the trains instead of fluorescent lighting, including display panels where graphics, public information messages, advertisements and station names had been displayed on these panels, which added a touch of magic in its aesthetic look. For commuters' convenience, another change was made in route maps. In Phase 3, LCD technology was used to display the dynamic route maps, which also helped passengers to understand metro routes easily. In Delhi Metro, most of the time, massive crowd builds up. In order to make metro ride easy and comfortable for daily commuters, DMRC enhanced the design as well as provided higher number of grab handrails for the standing passengers. In Phase 3, also a unique feature was added related to noise level reduction inside the train. It was reduced from the limit of 68 dB to 65 dB. Delhi Metro's new UTO, that is unattended train operation, enabled trains are now operating. The system significantly increased the level of punctuality and higher operational flexibility.
When we went for Phase 3, we realized that all the new metros across the world, wherever they are going for the CBTC type of signaling system and with the UTO, completely automatic system. There are obvious advantages of complete automation, CBTC. In case of CBTC, the obvious advantage is that you can run trains at much lesser headway. You can run train up to 90 seconds. So, meaning thereby that with shorter trains, you can carry same amount of traffic, you can have same capacity with increased frequency of the trains, and therefore it brings economy in terms of the size of the station and other infrastructure related to that. So this is how we decided to go with the latest technology available, and the advantages are obvious.
A quantum jump in technology has been attempted by DMRC in rolling stock field by going for driverless operation. Now there is no dependence on the driver, so the reliability level has increased many folds, as all human dependent errors have been eliminated totally. Again, there have been several other technological intervention in the field of high level of fire detection. Then there is a provision of automatic induction of the train, which will bring lot of optimization, and train can be inducted in the system conveniently.
Highest escalators in Janakpuri West. The world has seen many superstructures with impressive architecture, engineering and craftsmanship, and DMRC is one of them. DMRC achieved another feat by making highest escalators with highest elevation in Janakpuri West. The height of these escalators is equal to the height of a 5-story building. And it was not really easy to make, but was exciting and challenging. A 250-ton crane was specially planted for the establishment of these escalators. The height of the journey, 15.65 meters. Horizontal length, 35.32 meters. And total weight of each escalator, 26 tons. Finance. The Phase 3 project of Delhi Metro is one of the largest urban infrastructure projects in India. The execution of project involved management of large amount of funds. The Delhi Metro took up various measures to make optimum utilization of funds and made timely payments to contractors to ensure no delays in the project.
DMRC has a name in making payments to the contractors in time. This is one of the reasons for success of all phases of DMRC. Phase 3 cost is of the order of 49,000 crores. This includes phase 3 portions in NCR states of Haryana and Uttar Pradesh. As far as Delhi portion is concerned, the phase 3 is of the order of 39,000 crores, of which roughly 49%, about 19,800 crores, is funded from JICA. It will be appreciated that this is a mammoth project and it involves a very close intervention of all the stakeholders, that is the Government of India, Government of Delhi and JICA, and not to mention that Delhi DMRC team itself has been very actively involved.
Metro expansion in NCR. The Delhi Metro Network successfully connected the far-flung areas of the National Capital Region, NCR, in Phase 3 and made travelling much easier for passengers. While in Phase 2, the cities of Noida, Ghaziabad and Gurugram were added to the Delhi Metro network for the first time. The Delhi Metro further expanded its wings far and wide to more satellite cities of the NCR in Phase 3. Today, Delhi Metro stretches to Noida and Ghaziabad in the state of Uttar Pradesh and Gurugram, Faridabad, Bahadurgarh and Ballabgarh in the state of Haryana.
The Mundka-Bahadurgarh corridor was earlier envisaged as a normal corridor with normal standard spans and normal stations. But at execution stage, there were major modifications to be done for this corridor so as to accommodate the future metro stations and the future road development plans of NHAI and UER2. The major challenge was at MIA station, where DDA intimated that there will be a proposed corridor along the UER2 corridor, where this will be intersecting the Bahadurgarh corridor at MIA. So they requested to construct the MIA station as an integrated station to accommodate the future station also.
Construction of Noida Greater Noida section. Today, Delhi Metro stands as the proudest achievement of modern India. It is one of the construction wonders of the recent times. The Delhi Metro story is considered the beginning of the metro revolution in India. The rapidly expanding Delhi Metro has not only spread its wings in Delhi NCR region, but has also ventured deep into the other cities of the country. In 2014, approvals were received for the construction of a 29.7 kilometers metro line linking Noida with Greater Noida. And the Delhi Metro Rail Corporation, DMRC, was appointed as the key consultant for the project. DMRC was given the responsibility of constructing the world-class infrastructure of Noida Metro and commenced the construction activity of the corridors in 2015. Today, it is one of the fastest constructed elevated metro corridors using precast girders. In May 2016, Delhi Metro Rail Corporation achieved the feat of launching 200 girders in a single month. And again in October, a new record was set with the launch of 218 girders. This rare feat by DMRC was entered into the prestigious Limca Book of Records in the year 2017. Combating challenges during the construction was not easy, but a dedicated and self-motivated team of DMRC engineers led the project from the front.
The biggest challenge was to complete 30 kilometers of line with 21 stations, staff quarters and full-fledged depot in a very short span of 3.5 years. And let me put it forward that the first put in forward by our team with the support of all departments, we were able to complete this project well in time. In fact, the pace of construction was recognized by the LIMCA Book of Records also, where we launched more than 214 U-girders in 1 month on this line. There were major challenges of utility diversions like high tension line of 220 kV. So we came up with a very innovative solution where DMRC engineers actually found a new way of taking our alignment down so that the HT line diversion is saved. So not only we saved around more than 120 crores to organization, but we completed project well ahead of time.
All the 21 stations of this network have been built in record time of 20 months. Equipment rooms of the stations have been designed to have lesser spaces, and large areas have been allotted to concourses so as to facilitate smooth and free movement of the passengers. Known as the Aqua Line, this metro corridor starts from Sector 51 Metro Station and ends at Greater Noida Depot Station. The network has a total length of 29.7 kilometers with 21 stations. The Aqua Line began its passenger services on January 26, 2019. An idea which was conceived behind the doors turned into reality with the help of a committed and enthusiastic team of DMRC. And today it can be seen on the ground in the form of a world-class mass rapid transit system, that is Noida Metro. Role of business development. The Delhi Metro's journey for past 25 years has been remarkable. Over the years, DMRC faced numerous challenges as the metro network continued to expand. However, the DMRC team overcame difficulties and made sure that the projects were completed before set targets. Today, the Delhi Metro is among the biggest and best metros in the world. This did not happen overnight. This reputation has been earned by showing high standards of competency and reliability over the last 25 years. The transformation of the metro services in the country cannot be imagined without the Delhi Metro. The metro revolution in India began with the success of Delhi Metro. Now, DMRC is guiding other metros in India by sharing its experience, knowledge and manpower to develop world-class facilities across the country. While DMRC was the prime consultant for the Chennai, Kolkata and Bengaluru metro projects, it is now working as a general consultant for the Dhaka metro project in Bangladesh, the Jaipur, Kochi, Noida, Greater Noida, Mumbai and Patna projects have DMRC involved on a turnkey basis. DMRC has also provided interim consultancy for many other metro projects in the country. Further, DMRC is providing its consultancy services to metros in other countries as well. DMRC is also emphasizing on utilizing its expertise for operation and maintenance for other metros. A large pool of officers and staff who have been trained, groomed in the operation and maintenance are using their experience in establishing and running the metros in different cities across India.
DMRC is further expanding its expertise in other modes of transport, with, for example, Metro Lite, Metro Neo, pod systems, ropeway systems, and we will be the first ones, pioneers, to make detailed project reports for the latest modes of transport for other cities. In fact, for the cities of Uttarakhand, we are in making project reports for Metro Lite, for ropeway and pod system also.
Now, Delhi Metro is grasping new opportunities in international market, and the experience gained in the last 25 years proved to be highly useful. The task of planning and execution of an international project often comes with unique challenges and specific localized considerations. The DMRC is well equipped and capable enough to handle all such challenges.
This is how the consultancy business has grown in DMRC in the last 25 years. With this expertise, let me also put it forward that we are supporting Dhaka Metro also. And we did support some, to an extent, smaller extent, to Jakarta Metro also. So we intend to go international also, because the kind of best solutions our people are able to offer, there is a huge demand of DMRC offices, not only in country, but abroad also. So our consultancy business is now, you can see, we started from scratch, from nil in 2000, to a full-fledged organization supporting other metros in 2021. There's a big future, and we intend to deliver the best to the other cities as per their requirement.
For Delhi Metro, its journey to becoming one of the best metros in the world was not easy. The hard work, dedication, and futuristic planning of DMRC made it what it is today. The team Delhi Metro will continue to excel and shine brighter. Safety. In comparison to Phase 1 and Phase 2, DMRC faced a variety of challenges during the construction work of Phase 3. The biggest challenge came across while working on the busiest roads during the execution of Phase 3, which had a different inventory of a very fast-moving traffic.
The major difference between the Phase 3 work and the earlier work which we have undertaken was our challenges of working on roads which were very busy and had a different inventory of traffic at a very high speed. Whereas when we were undertaking our work in Phase 3, the traffic was very fast because we were working on ring roads, both outer as well as inner ring road.
DMRC launched a very ambitious project for training of construction workers for minimum requirement of 96 hours of safety, health and environment. And large number of workers underwent this training.
The second aspect was the sheer scale of this project. We were expecting close to 30,000 workers coming and working on a daily basis at our projects. And we all know in construction, the skill set of the workers who come and work with us is low. So sensitizing them and then bringing them on board to follow safety was also a challenge which we have been facing in past, but because of the sheer volume, we were expecting this to be a little more difficult this time.
In any construction work, machinery plays a pivotal role. The health of the machinery is very crucial for safe execution of the critical lifting operations. DMRC imposed a clause of restriction of using the old age cranes. In Phase 3, only new heavy machineries were deployed, which made a huge difference in executing the work.
We, as a DMRC corporate requirement and a client requirement, imposed a clause of a restriction on the age of the cranes. There were initial hiccups, there were challenges, but slowly we started getting very good response, and we have been able to have an incidence-free lifting operation where we had large number of sets of cranes which were being used during the night hours. DMRC insisted on mobilization of second generation pick and carry Hydra cranes. If you have a much more sturdier machine with a better center of gravity and a balance, probably the challenges may be mitigated.
Overhead electrification challenges. On the electrical front as well, a number of challenges were encountered by DMRC's engineers in implementing the traction-related infrastructure for the Phase 3 corridors. Initially, detailed design consultants were appointed for designing the 25 kV overhead traction system for some of the sections under Phase 3. Using the experience gained during the implementation of Phase 1 and Phase 2 traction systems, DMRC's engineers could critically review the designs submitted by traction DDCs. As one of the important achievements, the average span of the OHE masts on the viaduct could be increased by about 33% thus resulting in substantial savings in the cost of erection component of OHE. Also, OHE for some of the sections under Phase 3 was designed through in-house efforts by DMRC. With acquired experience and further development of in-house expertise in DMRC, the traction team is now capable of taking up complete design of traction systems for metro networks. In Delhi NCR, the menace of birds carrying conducting wires and dropping them on the OHE is very common. This sometimes results in grounding of OHE and finally snapping of OHE wires. Bridging of OHE cantilever insulators by birds is also very rampant in this region. For a lasting solution, DMRC innovated the designs for protection of OHE against such occurrences and designed anti-bird discs and provided them on insulators at all such locations. After the provisions of these discs on the insulators, the problem of bridging of insulators has been almost overcome. Now, even Indian Railways has started following DMRC's designed modifications in their system. Since fault currents in DMRC network are as high as 14 kA against 7 kA in Indian Railways' 25 kV traction system, design of the OHE jumpers was modified to suit higher currents in the DMRC traction network. Crimped type joints in place of parallel grooved bolted joints were used for providing electrical continuity of OHE wires. Continuity jumpers were also strengthened to cater to higher load currents and fault currents. At feeding posts, OHE was strengthened and provision of Panto flashover relays at all feeding posts were mandatorily made. Since the environment of Delhi NCR is very heavily polluted, aluminium OHE cantilevers in place of MS cantilevers were used in DMRC network. Composite insulators of 1600 mm creepage distance were developed and used in place of conventional 1250 mm creepage distance insulators. This adaptation not only improved the reliability considerably, but also reduced the maintenance requirements. Similarly, many more innovations to improve the reliability of OHE were evolved and implemented. This has paid the dividends and the reliability of OHE has improved to a considerable extent. Use of renewable solar power. Delhi Metro installed the largest rooftop solar plant in Delhi. It's a first of its kind initiative through which Delhi Metro Rail Corporation produces power for all operations at Dwarka Sector 21 station. The plant, which can generate up to 500 kilowatt every day, is the largest of its kind in NCR under the renewable energy service model and is a result of cooperation between DMRC and GIZ through ComSolar, a project that supports commercialization of solar energy in India. This initiative to meet DMRC's power requirements is an all-out effort to promote renewable energy.
The DMRC in October 2012 decided to sign an MOU with GIZ Germany to find out alternative ways of utilizing the rooftops for installing the solar plant. The first solar plant installation of rooftop was taken up at Dwarka Sector 21 metro station and was dedicated to the nation on August 2014.
Metro system to survive, it has to be energy efficient because metro system entirely runs on electricity and the cost of electricity is almost one third of the total operation cost. So during the phase 3 on initiative of the central government, our Prime Minister's National Solar Mission, DMRC decided to go in a big way solar power, that is known as clean power also. And this was also an initiative to make the Delhi Metro a little more greener.
In order to mitigate carbon footprints, DMRC is trying to maximize the use of renewable energy by utilizing all possible rooftops for harnessing solar energy. For this, a target of 20 megawatt power generation capacity was set for August 2017. But DMRC managed to achieve the target in July 2017. till date, 32.4 megawatt capacity from rooftop solar have been commissioned in DMRC under RESCO model. After utilization of all available rooftop space, DMRC decided to procure solar power from off-site Reva Ultra Mega Solar Power Plant for other operational requirements. DMRC has been involved in this project from concept to commissioning stage, and the actual flow of energy to DMRC started on 18th April 2019 through interstate open access.
सौर ऊर्जा आज की नहीं बल्कि 21वीं सदी की ऊर्जा जरूरतों का एक बड़ा माध्यम होने वाला है। दिल्ली में मेट्रो रेल तक को रीवा से लाभ मिलेगा।
Care for the environment. Improving and maintaining the Earth's environment is becoming a more important task every day of our lives. Care for the environment has always been one of DMRC's priority areas. In all phases of its functioning, right from planning to construction and then operations, utmost care is taken to conserve the environment. All the new metro stations in Phase 3 have been certified as Platinum by the Indian Green Building Council. These stations are designed with specific provisions for the conservation of energy as well as more CO2 saving, water saving, waste management, energy management and optimized building design to reduce the size of station box and hence lesser use of construction materials.
The DMRC team got in touch with the Indian Green Building Council and we developed a rating system which would certify our structures to being green. Since IGBC did not have the bench strength to develop such a model, so DMRC along with IGBC developed this rating system for the metros. So we were the first to certify ourselves in this system, and then this IGBC rating system for the metros is now being followed by all the metros in the country. All our stations of Phase 3 are certified to the highest rating, which is Platinum.
Disposal of C&D waste. Urban spaces and suburban areas across the country are witnessing continuous construction activities for residential, commercial and development purpose. While the infrastructure building is an essential step to support the growing population and modernization, it brings forward various inconveniences, mainly those related to pollution. Controlling and managing pollution was one of the major challenges during the Phase 3 construction faced by DMRC. And through a strategic and consistent effort, DMRC could achieve the desired results. The management of C&D waste is of major concern due to various reasons. C&D waste, if not managed properly, leads to choking of surface drains, disrupts traffic, and leaves a bad impact on the urban landscape. DMRC started managing C&D waste generated during construction waste even before it was mandatory under any regulation or law. DMRC has been recycling C&D waste since 2014, even though it was not required at that point of time. As per the C&D Waste Management Rules 2016, procurement of materials made from C&D waste is mandatory to a certain percentage, that is 10 to 20% in municipal and government contracts. In compliance of these rules, provisions of procurement of 10% of C&D recycled products for external development and roadworks for finishing contracts has been incorporated in Phase 4 contract conditions. DMRC has studied the entire C&D waste generation and its process cycle in great detail and created infrastructure to make construction waste useful. Today, DMRC uses various types of techniques and equipment to process C&D waste materials into reusable and marketable products. At DMRC construction sites, C&D waste is segregated properly and stored and kept covered at a designated place. This waste stored at the site is then transported to a recycling facility in covered trucks. To recycle the C&D waste, DMRC has set up a C&D waste recycling facility of 150 TPD capacity at Ranikheda, Mundka, in an area of approximately 3 acres. The plant was inaugurated in August 2017 and was made operational in April 2018. This plant is based on wet processing technology, which helps in minimizing process residues as well as dust and noise pollution. About 95% of incoming C&D waste is recovered and recycled at this recycling facility. To date, DMRC has recycled more than 3 lakh tons of C&D waste. To promote the use of recycled products, use of C&D waste products has been made mandatory in finishing and road work contracts through contractual provisions. Different kinds of products are being recovered after recycling of the C&D waste, including aggregates, sand, recovery of silt soil and value-added products like curb stones, pavement blocks and concrete bricks, etc. DMRC has always been open to bringing in new ideas, technology and take up initiatives for shaping a better future. Over the past 2 decades, DMRC has earned a reputation as a visionary organization for its futuristic planning and sustainable construction practices. Some of the initiatives started by DMRC have now become standard practices in the construction field and are being followed by other organizations as well. Art and culture. Art and culture is an essential part of any society. Art also influences society by changing opinions, instilling values, and translating experiences across space and time. Art is a mode of communication. It allows people from different cultures and different times to communicate with each other via images, crafts, and stories. DMRC is working towards promoting the rich heritage, art, and culture of India through artworks, display panels and exhibits at its stations. DMRC has also tied up with various government bodies or organizations and schools, authorizing them to use the metro premises in such a way that they are treated as a hub for promotion of Indian art, culture, literature, craft, tourism, etc.
In underground stations, we use the artwork of various artists in the digital form in the glass. That is a major diversion from our phase 1, phase 2 stations. For underground stations, we generally use granite as a cladding material within this in the station walls. But here, we have used the glass, and the glass, it is digitally printed, taking the images of renowned artists. So, from the gallery, the artworks have been used in the station premise in a public space. So art in public area, it was a concept being promoted majorly in the underground stations.
Delhi Metro's Phase 3 stations have been utilized for the portrayal of the history and heritage of the country. Various artists, including professionals and amateurs, were used to create these artworks, and different artwork was displayed at each station, which also helped to enhance the beauty of these stations. Transport systems around the world are in a race against time to modernize their services and serve an increasing number of passengers with much higher expectations from their daily journeys. Delhi Metro has been meeting the expectations of the passengers for the last several years, and Delhi Metro is on the path of setting new records, touching new heights, and moving towards its destination by easing all the difficulties and challenges without any halt.
DMRC has got a very unique type of experience where DMRC develop the system, then operate, use this experience in further development, and then in succession, improvement from phase 1 to phase 2 and then phase 3 and now in phase 4. This type of experience, I think nobody in the world has got.
बिखेरे हम चेहरों पे मुस्कान, सफलता बन गई है हमारी पहचान,
दिल्ली की हम है जान।
हम में है कुछ खास,
हम में है कुछ बात।